Human beings first set foot outside the continent of Africa about 180,000 years ago. And ever since then, we've been on a technological odyssey that's enabled us to overcome just about every hurdle and obstacle that's come our way during our journey through history. The fossil fuels of coal, oil, and gas have provided the energy to drive many of these technologies for the last 150 years or so. But we all know that their byproduct is air pollution and the release of vast quantities of carbon dioxide into our atmosphere. But back in 1934, an Italian physicist by the name of Enrico Fermi came along and conducted a series of experiments that resulted in a process that had the potential to transform energy generation forever. And that process was nuclear fission. Hello and welcome to Just Have a Think. I'll be honest with you, I've grappled with exactly how to present this video on the subject of modern nuclear power generation. The quantities of comparatively clean energy that the technology offers are truly staggering, but the challenges and caveats are not insignificant either. Add to that a world that's changing at an exponential rate before our very eyes, not just technologically, but socially, politically, and environmentally as well, and the picture becomes less and less clear. According to the World Nuclear Association, around 11% of the world's electricity is currently generated by about 450 nuclear power reactors. This is an interactive map that you can find at carbonbrief.org. I'll leave a link down in the description box below. The map shows the location, type, and size of each reactor and its current operational status. The International Energy Association tells us that nuclear power is the world's second largest source of low carbon power after hydro, producing about 30% of the total global low carbon mix in 2016. The United States is by some distance the largest producer of nuclear energy today. In 2018, total US electricity generation was 4,178 terawatt hours. And as a reminder, a terawatt is a billion kilowatts or a million megawatts. 35% of America's energy, about 1,468 terawatt hours, comes from gas. 1,146 terawatt hours, or about 27%, still comes from coal-fired power plants, and then comes nuclear at 807 terawatt hours, or about 19%, and the rest is made up of the fast-growing renewable sector. But of course, as with everything else that's got anything to do with power generation, China is catching up fast, and we'll come back to that in a moment. Nuclear power generation comes with its own unique set of pros and cons, some of which are technological and some of which are more societal in nature. The Renewable Resources Coalition considered each of these in this report at their website, which we'll link in the description box below as well. In the upside column, nuclear power provides baseload energy generation. That means it doesn't fluctuate. It's a reliable and constant source of power for the grid. Compared to coal, gas, and other electric generating plants, nuclear produces by far the lowest greenhouse gas emissions, roughly equivalent to renewable technologies, in fact. Nuclear energy's got an incredibly high fuel to power output ratio. A kilo of nuclear fuel, typically uranium, releases millions of times more energy than a kilo of coal. Although initial costs to build nuclear plants are very high and often go way over budget, something we'll look at later, once a plant is actually up and running, nuclear power produces relatively inexpensive electricity, certainly cheaper than gas or coal. It doesn't rely on fossil fuels of any kind, so it's not affected by fluctuations in those commodity prices. Based on current global availability of uranium, there's enough to last at least 80 years or so, and some say that makes nuclear energy the perfect transition fuel as we move towards a renewable energy future. More recently, there's been a resurgence in interest in a technology called molten salt reactors based on the far more abundant element, thorium. The technicalities of how each type of nuclear power plant actually work are well outside the scope of this video and probably outside the scope of this channel, to be honest, but essentially, molten salt reactors, which were first developed in the 1960s, use salts both as a receptacle for the fuel source and as a coolant for the reaction itself, which according to the clever engineering bods, is a very smart piece of lateral thinking. It does away with the need to use water for cooling, which was the principal cause of the accidents at both Chernobyl and Fukushima. Thorium comes into the picture as an attractive alternative to mining the relatively rare resource of uranium. According to LiveScience.com, thorium is about as abundant as lead and at least three times as abundant as uranium. And the chemists can mess with thorium to turn it into something called fissile uranium-233, which apparently is what molten salt reactors need as a fuel source. And that leads us to the point I mentioned earlier, the rapidly expanding Chinese nuclear energy program. According to the International Energy Agency, in 2016, China had 1,625 gigawatts of electricity generation. Despite its exponential growth in all renewables technologies, more than the rest of the world combined in fact, 58% of their energy still comes from coal. Climate Action Tracker tells us that China's nationally determined contribution to the 2015 Paris Agreement is to reduce carbon emissions down to 60 to 65% below 2005 levels by 2030. To achieve that goal, China is embarking on a staggering drive towards renewable energy, as this 2040 projection demonstrates very clearly. But China's plan also relies on a doubling of its current nuclear power generation from 2% of the overall mix to 4% in 2040. And that put China just behind the US as the second largest nuclear energy producer in the world. Developing thorium molten salt reactors rather than the more traditional light water reactors will save China massively on uranium imports. The current thorium reserves of China are estimated to be about 280,000 tons. But what about nuclear's downside column? Well, of course, one of the biggest concerns is the environmental impact of spent nuclear fuel. A typical nuclear power plant generates about 20 tons of used nuclear fuel every year, and that spent fuel is highly radioactive and extremely hazardous to life. You can't just dump it in a landfill site. It has to be carefully handled, stored, and constantly managed, in some cases for hundreds or even thousands of years, before it reaches acceptable levels of safety. All of that comes at huge financial cost, not to mention the potential ecological and environmental catastrophe that any breach of containment might result in. Here in the UK, decades after the first nuclear power plant opened, there still isn't a safe storage site for this country's nuclear waste. And then there's public perception of safety at the nuclear power plants themselves. Three Mile Island in 1978, Chernobyl in 1986, and Fukushima in 2011 were all very high-profile accidents that brought those public fears to the surface. According to the UN, the worst disaster at Chernobyl caused the death of 30 workers and radiation injuries to over 100 others. 115,000 people were immediately evacuated from areas surrounding the reactor, and another 220,000 people were subsequently relocated from Belarus, the Russian Federation, and Ukraine. The accident caused serious social and psychological disruption in the lives of those affected and vast economic losses over the entire region. Large areas of the three countries were contaminated with radioactive materials, and radionuclides from the Chernobyl release were measurable in all countries in the Northern Hemisphere. According to Cancer Research UK, Chernobyl could eventually result in around 4,000 cancer deaths in those exposed to the radiation from the accident. This chart, which you can find at the website Our World in Data, is based on figures from polls conducted by Ipsos Mori after the Fukushima disaster in 2011. Public opinion varied from country to country, but the global average showed that 62% of the population were opposed to nuclear energy as a means of generating electricity. While those working in the nuclear industry will no doubt point to a very good operational safety record, the politicians will tell you that perception is everything. And generally speaking, public opinion shows a huge fear of nuclear accidents. Then there's the fact that nuclear energy isn't a renewable resource. Typical renewable energy sources such as solar and wind are in infinite supply. And by contrast, uranium has to be mined, synthesized, and then activated to produce energy, all of which is a very expensive process to go through. Last but by no means least are the upfront costs that we talked about earlier, as well as technical delays and long project overruns. This commentary comes direct from the Bulletin of the Atomic Scientists website. The capital costs of a nuclear power plant are much higher than for energy sources such as coal and natural gas, and the annual cost of repaying the initial investment is substantially higher than the annual operating costs. This is because nuclear power plants are technically complex and must satisfy strict licensing and design requirements. The design and construction of a new nuclear power plant requires many highly qualified specialists and often takes many years, compounding financing costs, which can become significant. In 2017, two South Carolina utilities abandoned two unfinished Westinghouse AP1000 reactors due to difficulties in equipment manufacturing, significant construction delays, and cost overruns. The latest three power plants being built in Western Europe, in Flamanville in France, Yrjöki in southwest Finland, and Hinkley Point in Somerset, England, have all been beset by a litany of cost overruns and delays. Flamanville, originally hailed as a flagship project for French energy provider EDF and scheduled to open in 2012, has been a fiasco, recently delayed by a further 3 years due to faulty welds on the containment vessel. The project costs now stand at over $12 billion, almost four times the original budget, and the plant will be 12 years late, assuming it even opens at all. Finland's Olkiluoto 3 reactor, originally targeted for a 2009 production start, now looks like finally coming online in February 2020 at a cost of nearly $9 billion, almost three times its original budget. Hinkley Point was due to open in 2017, but its owner, EDF, now says it's scheduled for 2025 at a cost of £20.3 billion, almost £3 billion over budget. Our UK government plans to attract outside investors into the ongoing construction of the plant by forcing British taxpayers to take up the burden of the project overspend. Commenting on this tactic, the influential government economic advisor Dieter Helm said, "No smart contracting or regulating framework can magic away the deep challenges that nuclear faces, notably the possibility that in the next 60 years much cheaper new low-carbon technologies may become available, possibly including new nuclear ones, the very large upfront and sunk costs, the risk and the safety regulation, and the challenges of getting rid of the waste." Nevertheless, developments in nuclear technology have boosted confidence amongst those in the industry, and that confidence has been bolstered somewhat by ill-considered energy policy decisions by some governments, most notably Japan and Germany. In the wake of the Fukushima disaster in 2011, the mighty European powerhouse of Germany, led by Chancellor Merkel, took the decision to close down all of its nuclear power plants by 2022 as part of its commitment to reduce carbon emissions by 80 to 95% by 2050. But despite some progress in that direction, Germany is nowhere near where it should be. And ironically, it's had to lean heavily on its coal industry to bridge the resultant energy gap, with the result that today, nearly a quarter of all electricity produced in that country still comes from burning lignite, otherwise known as brown coal. In fact, according to the International Energy Agency, Germany is the world's leader in the mining and burning of this dirtiest of all fossil fuels. And if you were to suggest that this is better than keeping existing nuclear plants open as an interim power source, I suspect most people would probably disagree with you. Closing down existing nuclear power plants that provide safe, low-carbon, reliable baseload energy for our electricity grids does seem like a rather rash policy decision, but it could equally be argued that it's less than prudent to be investing vast sums of money in long-term projects that are racked with potential complications and technical difficulties when far quicker, easier and cheaper alternatives in the renewable sector are flooding onto the market alongside fast improving energy storage solutions at a time when we're being told by the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change and the UK Committee on Climate Change that we have at most about 12 years to transform our energy, transport and land management policies if we're to stand any chance at all of meeting the target of keeping our planet's average atmospheric temperature to less than 2 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels. I know there'll be plenty of points that you folks quite rightly will want to add to the discussion, and as always, I'll read your feedback in the comments section with great interest. But that's it for this little presentation. Please do give us a like and a share if you did find the programme useful and informative, and if you haven't already done so, please do subscribe to the channel to help raise our profile with the YouTube search algorithm thingamabobs. Your subscription really does make a difference. It is, of course, completely free and dead easy to subscribe. All you need to do is click on that icon there. As always, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.